So I'm talking about rejection and failure, kind of on like a bigger picture. I use some of my own specific examples, which pertain to entertainment and television and my product pitches over the years. I pitched a lot of products in the toy business, and still, from time to time, I come up with products, but in the old days, I used to have meetings with toy companies, and I try and sell the idea to the toy company, and I try and get production behind the scenes, and then we try and sell it to Walmart or whoever. I don't do that anymore, because I have an audience. I can sell things directly to my audience. So there really is no rejection, and there really is no failure. It's just things that didn't work out, and it's up to you to, you're in full control, man. In this day and age, in this age of technology, it's completely up to you as the creator to start a YouTube channel, cultivate it, treat it like a baby that needs to be fed and groomed and taken care of every day until you grow it, whether it's your Instagram, whether it's your YouTube channel, or whether it's just your regular business that doesn't really involve social media. It is a baby that needs to be taken care of. It's like a Tamagotchi egg. Anybody remember that?
Yes.
Those are funny. So, like I said, rejection and failure is just sort of like an introductory concept, but at the end of the day, I don't think rejection and failure really exist like it did in the day of the gatekeepers. Like, you know, Jared, for instance, TV, you know what it's like trying to go and pitch a show and be talking to people that you know don't know anything more than you. They just happen to have a different job than you, and you know, they may invalidate your idea because it's just not the right time, or they don't like it, or whatever, but nowadays you go to a meeting, you leave, and you go, I'm just going to do my own YouTube channel. And, you know, it's easier said than done, but it's a total level playing field for any one of us. Basically, the underlying theme of all this is something Barry Katz, who is a manager, has a successful podcast called Industry Standard, and I always refer to Barry because he's been a mentor to me as far as some of the behind-the-scenes stuff. He's a comedic manager. He's managed everywhere, anybody from Dave Chappelle to Louis C.K. to any comedian that you could possibly think of. Barry has met them and worked with them. Anyway, Barry's podcast is really good. But one thing he always says is, if you're undeniable, you will not be denied. And so that's a mantra that you should all live by if social media and YouTube is your thing. If you're undeniable, you will not be denied. You gotta make good content, you gotta make incredible products, whatever it is. Just keep that in mind. Becoming an influencer is a long play goal. So if this is going to be something you want to do, you want to be an influencer, YouTuber, Instagrammer, it's a long play goal. You're doing it right now because you love it. You're not doing it for the money. And I used a metaphor last night. Let me see where this slide is. There's no backup plan. If it's something you want to do, you really got to do it. But one safe way to approach it is if your lifestyle is something you can't stand, say you're a programmer or you work at a corporate company and you want to move out of that into a world of making things, you got to picture if anybody edits. When you put a transition in a timeline, there's a big long diagonal. And this is your old life and this is your new life. And it's a crossfade. It's a long crossfade. And keep that in mind, that when you're in the shit, things aren't going well, you're in the crossfade. And it's just anything you do that will move in that direction of coming through that transition and coming out on the other side where you want to be. Believe me, it's so funny, my brother called me and he's like, what's going on? I'm like, a couple months ago I made these red stands for my friend's pop-up shop. I made these 10, 15 stands. I think I made 20 of them, 12, I don't know. All I know is I had to make them in like 3 days. It's just when the weather started getting cold, I started painting them, they were sticky for like 2 days, I delivered them sticky. And my brother called me, I'm like, I'm going through hell, I'm trying to get this paint to dry, I'm like running the heaters in the shop, and the paint's not dry, I gotta deliver them. And he goes, oh, the world famous Jimmy Diresta still has to deal with client problems, huh? And I'm like, yeah, I'm not. So, when you get stuck in a situation like that, it's just a bump in the road, it's a learning experience. I should have painted it sooner. Should have painted it when it was warmer, or I should have heated the shop. You know, you try to remember these things. So, it's a long play goal. Everything you do, you still have to do the things you don't want to do, and you do the things you want to do. It's like, at night, you work in the shop, at day, you go to a regular job, which pays for everything. There's no backup plan. If you really want to do this, this is what you want to do. You know, you found yourself. This is your life. This is it. This is our people. This is what you want to do. Short-term goal is to make amazing content. So if your long-term goal is to be an influencer on YouTube, right now you gotta make killer content. You gotta make really cool content that will live on its own. You wanna make self-contained little islands of video that will go traveling around the world and people will find you through that. And you know, how many times, like, you know, it's like once a week, like one little thing makes the rounds, you know, whether it's a cat playing the piano or something. But any one of these little pieces of killer, cool, fun content strikes that emotional nerve with people and it gets sent around. So, and me as a public person, I'll get, like, if something really cool goes around, A couple of weeks ago, there was a thing where a bunch of bricks, the guy flips the bricks, they go,
Yeah.
It was sent to me like by 17 people. Did you see this? Is really cool. But like stuff like that, like there's something cool about that little thing. There's something really like attractive about that, and that's what you want in your content. And again, at the very start, don't do it because you want to make money. Do it because you know that one day you'll make money. These are, and I just talked about bricks, but these, all this like really good content that you make in the beginning is gonna start to plant seeds. And that's, I added a slide to the show, I said plant seeds. Creative life is a series of highs and lows. Keep your long-term goals always in focus and expect rejection and shitty jobs along the path. I mean, you're gonna have to deal with shit. Like I said, you're in the shit. You're gonna have to, I remember I had done a TV show, I forget what show, I think I had done Hammer. It came and went. And then I was on the set I got hired by a prop company that was doing a VH1 title sequence. So we were in a big sound stage like this, shooting a title sequence. And it was about 4 months after we stopped shooting Hammer. And the low man on the totem pole at Hammer, who was like the associate producer, who went around and got water for everybody, he was like a mid-level producer on this shoot, and I was the hired help. So 4 months after my 30-episode TV series, the guy who was like, and I was always nice to him. You always gotta be nice to everybody. You can't be mean to anybody because you'll hear. And it's just my nature is to be nice to everybody. So I'm on the set, he's like, what are you doing here? I go, I'm helping build the props. He's like, what? I'm like, hey, man, life's a series of highs and lows. That show that we did is canceled, it's off, right? It doesn't exist anymore. It's like it never existed. So you just gotta, you can't be a prima donna. You gotta be able to take the highs and the lows. Creates character. Oh, this is kind of a joke, but it's really absolutely true. I wanna thank Discovery Channel for canceling my show, if anybody from Discovery Channel. Every end is a beginning, and it's really important to remember that. Every end is a new beginning, and it's so cliche, it's something your mother would say to you. You know, when your girlfriend dumps you, your mother's like, it's a new beginning, you do whatever you want now. It's really absolutely true, and we were getting pretty good ratings, and even like we had a lot of very experienced people on the set, the producers and the director, all like the Miami Ink, and we thought we were gonna be like the next big thing. And they're like, there's no reason why this show shouldn't get picked up. The ratings were like breaking 2 million on the first couple of episodes, but it just went away. And when it went away, my girlfriend said to me, you make these pitches all the time. Why don't you just make them every week and put them on YouTube? You don't have to deal with all these jerk-offs that, you know, never call you back and invalidate your ideas. It could be just you. And honestly, I thought for a second, I'm like, oh, that means I gotta do it. I really was waiting, and this in hindsight is the mistake, and now I've turned the corner, obviously. But I was really waiting for a production company to do all my dirty work. I just wanted to be the creator for Madonna on camera, and with my notebook in the corner off camera, coming up with ideas, and then when the camera's on, I'll be like, okay, give me my tools. And so I really wanted that lifestyle, and when it wasn't happening, my girlfriend said, you just gotta take control, you guys are gonna tail it. She's like, just take control, do it yourself. She goes, you don't have to talk to anybody. And I was like, okay, cool. So I started thinking, okay, at least let me do this until the next show comes along. And so I started doing YouTube videos, and it obviously was a turning point in my life. Because I can do whatever I want. I don't have to have a conversation about my concept. I was the creative director for all my own ideas. A little piece of my brain is out there in the world. I mean, like that one little snippet of like my vision, and it just lives on its own forever. And I make 10 more. I make cool bench, and you can just do whatever you want. And all of a sudden, these like little clips are starting to catch on. And it was a real big turning point. And it got to the point, and I say this all the time, a lot of people know, I've heard me say, I got on YouTube because I was mad at the TV business. And then I stayed on YouTube because I started getting some really beautiful emails from people saying, you're encouraging me to do my own thing, you're getting me out of my own fear factor. You know, the way you just slap things together and you're not worried about numbers and rulers and this, that, it gets me out of my uptight, you know, needing to be perfect. So when I started getting those encouraging emails from people that I'm helping people, it really changed my whole point of view and my focus. So none of that would have happened if I didn't get on Discovery and didn't get canceled. I, before the TV show started, I got into this like consumer thing where it's like, hey, do you want to be a product tester for DeWalt Tools? And I signed it, I came in, like I saw it on the internet, I'm like, yeah, I'll do that. And the guy came to me with some tools to test. He's like, we're going to be in your area, can we test some tools? I said, sure. And I'm like, hey, just in time, we're going to be shooting a TV show in a couple of days. And like, he's like, yeah, right, this fucking little shit shop is shooting a TV show. I'm like, no, for Discovery Channel, I swear. He's like, okay. I could just tell he didn't believe me. And then he sent me two little 12-volt tools. I'm like, send me some tools to put on the show. He sent me a 12-volt, like, drill and screwdriver. The little ones that this big. And so the show actually came out and aired, and then he started watching what I was doing. And he's like, oh, wow. Why don't we do a YouTube video? Let's try a YouTube series. So we came up with this idea where I was going to make that tool chest, and I was going to make it on top of a rolling box, and we're basically going to kind of make like a top box and a bottom, like toolbox, all out of wood. And so I made that first video, and I published the video. They paid me for a credit card. They didn't write me a check, I don't know why. Credit card. I had to get a Square account to get paid. And I said, great, let's make the second video. It's really doing well. They put the video on their channel. Even at this moment, that video is the number one video on their channel. DeWalt TV. The most viewed video is that toolbox. It's on my channel, it's on their channel. All the tools in that video, I bought before I even knew DeWalt. So I owned all those tools when they came to me. They gave me one thing, they gave me the track saw, because they didn't want to see me use my old table saw, the one that I had injured myself on. And so, when that video came out, I immediately became like the DeWalt monkey boy. Because everybody's like, oh, you're a DeWalt ham now. You get all free tools. I wish I got free tools. I'm like, no, I didn't get free tools. I don't need all these tools. They didn't even pay me yet. And so I immediately felt the wrath of like advertising and being in the public eye and being a sellout and how to manage that. And so DeWalt just like cut ties with me. They never answered me back. I never heard from them. I didn't know anything. People think that I'm getting paid by DeWalt, and I'm not. I wish I was. But I want to blow up this myth. How do I blow up this myth? And that's when I was like, what if I just paint my tools a different color? And I started thinking, every color is taken. Red is taken, yellow is taken, blue is taken. And I'm like, white is the only color that doesn't seem to be exploited as far as products go. And I didn't know, but Makita makes a white series of tools at the time. I didn't know that. And I painted all my tools white, and David Roller comes in and goes, oh, I got white Makita tools. Is that why you did it for Makita? No, I'm really trying to go with my own. And anyway, so that's why I painted my tools white. That's the story behind it, because I was upset that DeWalt wasn't paying attention to me after we started a relationship. They basically, you know, it's like you go on a couple of dates with a girl, you're really happy, and then she doesn't call you anymore. And you're like, oh, I thought this was going good. And so by painting my tools white, it kind of cemented my reputation as like a renegade, like a rebel, and all this other thing. So by me starting to paint my tools white just basically gave it made it clear to the viewer, I'm not getting paid by the company that has tools I'm using. And then when I stopped painting my tools, or when I started using brand new tools from DeWalt, it was clear that I was getting paid by them. And so that basically, it set a tone on my channel. And I'm not getting paid. If we don't have a deal, I'm not gonna show you tools. I mean, I didn't invent that idea, but some new YouTubers, like, they pick their own color and they paint their tools for that reason, I think. Another thing Barry always says is create holy shit moments. And holy shit moments are like, when you see a video and you're like, wow, that's fucking cool. Like, the only thing I can think of right now off the top of my head is, who are those guys that throw stuff and it always lands and stuff? What are they called?
Dude Perfect.
That, if you guys have watched Dude Perfect, they got like 70 billion views. And they're like, and it like like lands right on the cup. I don't know how. I would love to see the outtake reels. They should just do a channel of all the misses. But Dude Perfect is like it's just an ongoing holy shit moment. And if you haven't seen Dude Perfect, it's like a series of guys that are athletic guys, and they throw basketballs and frisbees and knives and stuff. And everything they throw lands where it goes. It's really amazing. So that's the type of holy shit moment. I guess my AK-47 is 11 million views right now. That's, I guess you could call that a holy shit moment. I didn't see it at the time. When I made that guitar, I made it for Wyclef. Wyclef and I got together through a friend of mine. And my friend said, hey, I'm with Wyclef in the studio. Can you come up here right now? We have an idea. I'm like, oh, cool, wow, you're with Wyclef. That was amazing. So I went up to the studio where they were together. And Wyclef wanted to make a guitar that was like a Peter Tosh guitar. Peter had made this. Peter Tosh played a guitar in protest of the war in Vietnam in the 70s. And he's like, I want to emulate that idea with a modern guitar, with a modern version of that weapon. We ended up coming up with the AK-47. And he's like, I got a video shoot in 4 days. Can you have something done for that video shoot? He's like, what? And so I went back. I left that meeting. I went and I bought an Ibanez guitar for $1,000. Went to my shop, and I immediately just started cutting it. But there was one or two days in between. The timing, it's just so funny, the timing. So I went back to my students and I said, hey, I just got this cool gig. I'm gonna be making this AK-47 guitar for Wyclef. One of my students goes, oh, I just shot a whole campaign, an anti-gun campaign, and I bought an airsoft AK-47. Do you want it? It's in my dorm room. I'm like, yeah. He's like, all right, I'll be right back. And it's obviously, it was one of the bigger moments. It was a holy shit moment that grew my channel. So having that one video be such a big viral video, grows my video. And anytime I meet anybody in the television business, which I still have meetings from time to time.
Man, love that AK-47, bro.
I wish you would watch other videos of mine. Because if you Google me, it's the person that shows up. There was like this macho handshake from some like guy this big. Plant seeds. This is like the new slide I added last night. All the while, plant seeds. At an event like this, plant seeds. Meet the people at Ryobi if you want to make a future relationship with them. Meet the people at Lincoln, at Home Depot. Plant seeds. Say hello. Give a cool card away. Plant seeds, because you never know. And a year from now, you'll have those viral videos on your channel. And all of a sudden, you're like, hey, remember you met me at WorkBenchcon? Oh my God, you've grown so much. Let's work together. So you plant seeds. You just say hello to people. You meet. You shake hands. Don't let the experts invalidate your ideas.
Timing may be just bad for
a pitch. Not a pick, a pitch. I can't spell, honestly. Don't let the experts invalidate your ideas. So when you do have meetings, leave the meetings and you dump it. Look, you know, if it doesn't go well, they never tell you anything. They're like, it's great, everything's awesome, I love it. And then they just don't call you back. And if you don't get that call back, don't feel invalidated. It's just not the right time. And of course, you want to have, you're pitching something that's undeniable and a holy shit thing, whatever it is. That person just didn't see it. And a lot of times when you're having meetings with people, it's really important to remember, you're an artist, you're a creative, they're a person that works in a company. You're the renegade, you're the person that is out in the wild. They've taken the safe position to work in a corporation. So, it's two different people from two different points of view. So the pitch is already at like, it's like a weird thing to begin with. So that's why you gotta make sure your work speaks for itself. You're gonna have a meeting with somebody and you're like, I swear this is cool. And you like don't even want to talk to them because you're like, how could you work in this corporate job? This sucks. I can't believe you work here. You want to let your work speak for itself. So that's been my own personal experience. And when I talk a little bit more about my own personal TV pitches, I almost never had meetings. Now we have Skype meetings. We don't actually have meetings. So now I have like a Skype pitch with a casting director from time to time. But when I pitched my very first show was Trash to Cash, I sent the video to Barry Katz, and I hadn't met him yet. My brother was working with him, but I hadn't met him personally. I sent him the video, and he picks up the phone and calls me and goes, I like this. So I didn't even have to talk to him. He called me, he goes, I'll represent this. Because at first he was like, wait, you're gonna pick, he told my brothers, you're gonna pick the garbage and make stuff? Do you really wanna be that guy that's like picking the garbage? I thought you wanna be an actor. And my brother's like, no, it's gonna be a funny show, I swear. So when I sent him the pitch that we shot in 2001, he liked it because I like it, because it's too long, but I like it. Because when I come to New York, let's sit down. He came to New York, we sat down at Final Cut Pro on my computer, and we edited it. We made a 20-minute video into to a 7-minute video, and then he emailed that video to somebody at Fox. The guy saw it, called up and said, let's have a meeting. So the idea preceded the meeting, which made the meeting go a lot easier. I didn't have to sell it, it sold itself. Advertisers and producers don't know your audience as well as you, so as a content creator, again, the type of adversity or rejection you might face is you're sitting down with Home Depot or Lincoln or somebody, and you say, hey, this is the kind of concept I want to do to represent your product, and you're like, no, you got to do it this way. Now you've been rejected, your idea failed. You have to be able to tell them, look, I know my audience, and I know what my audience likes. Because you develop a relationship with your audience, especially when you start growing as big as me and Bob. And you start to develop a relationship, you know what they respond to, you read your comments, you get the beautiful emails, and the advertisers don't. And there's no doubt there are people in this business that are small and very calculated, and you know, can crunch the numbers, and I'm talking about any business. But a lot of times it's good timing and a lot of luck with good timing, and also a lot of hard work. But when you have meetings with television people, sometimes it's frustrating. You're sitting across from somebody and you're like, you just stepped in the shit that I tell you. Let your work speak for itself. This is a little redundant, but it's really important to just, again, when I sold TV show concepts, I sent videos before I even had an email. If you're not allowed in the front door, go in the back door. This goes back to, and I said this the other night, when I was a kid and we'd go to clubs in the city, and we'd like walk up to the Palladium and there's like 700 people in line. I'd be like, let's just go to the back door where they like take deliveries. Let's figure out how to get in this club without waiting on that line. And that's been my approach to everything. Look at what everybody else is doing and do something completely different. Social media is an amazing entry. Show off your products, not your dinners. So if you want to be in this game, you've got the joke. If you want to be in this game of producing content, artwork, whatever it is, if you're photographing your art, then just make it consistent. It's nice when you open up somebody's Instagram and you scroll through and it's just like all, it has like this texture of whatever it is that person. It's not like a picture of a cool car that has nothing to do with them just because they liked it. It's a picture of it. I mean, if you're going to cultivate, that is your art gallery, basically, these days. Your art gallery is Instagram, so you want your art gallery to be curated. You want to put up tasteful, cool pictures of people that either inspire you. You know, like I put up a picture last night of me and Ben. Ben is an amazing, inspirational dude. And every time I hang out with him, I learn something new. And then, you know, we're also cross-promoting each other, you know, in this game. We want to, all water rises all boats, I guess, whatever that saying is. But it's important to cultivate that social media platform. And Taylor has sold so many chairs through her Instagram, and she doesn't even do a good job at it. But people go to her Instagram, and they see the chair she's made, and they email it directly or Instagram her, Instagram messenger, and she sold a lot of chairs through Instagram. So people say, how do I start selling my products? Make your products and put them on Instagram. Now, there was a day where you would make your product, bring it either through like a juried craft show, and then that person would jury your work and say, this is good enough for you to spend $500 for a booth. I'm gonna let you into my craft show. Now everybody's craft show is full-time on Instagram. You don't need to go to these shows. You don't need to, I mean, obviously you can open an Etsy account, or you can open Amazon's looking to do a handcraft. So that's why I said at the beginning of this talk, there really is no gatekeepers anymore. The only gatekeeper is you. You've gotta figure out how to package yourself. Find a place to sell it. Ignore the gatekeepers. Create personal attachments with your audience. I just talked about these ice picks, posters, simple interactions will filter back to producers and advertisers. You know, be nice to the people you meet. Like I said, it just comes to me naturally. I'm not like working at trying to be nice. It's just how my mom raised me. But it's important because then you meet people, and you know, I've met people here like, oh, I heard so much about you. I'm so glad we finally met. Oh, that's really great. You know, I have a good reputation. I hope that filters back to the people that will eventually we'll work together. Beware of opportunities, and be conscious of opportunities. I say beware, like that sounded a little negative in sentencing of that. But be conscious of opportunities, and the example is Making It is the name of our podcast with Bob and Dave. And I was leading up to my participation in the show Making It, now called Making It. but before the name was Mayhem, it was called the Handmade Project. And actually, there are a few minutes for questions. So the Handmade Project, I was getting cast as the master helper on that show. And they said, hey, we want to talk to you about the title of the show. I'm like, okay, cool. So I pick up the phone, let's talk in an hour. I'm talking to the producer. I'm like, yeah, what's up? She's like, yeah, we want to name the show. We came up with a really good name. I'm like, yeah, what is it? She's like, Megan. I'm like, yeah, that's a great name. That's the name of my podcast. She's like, I know. I'm like, oh, you want to name the show the name of my podcast? She's like, yeah. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, she's like, we're going to give you X. And she said a number. I thought this one, we're going to discuss the number publicly. But it was a year's salary, basically. And I'm like, eh. I go, you know, that might seem like a lot of money. I said, well, we got to split it three ways, and we make that much money anyway. I said, so we put 5 years into this title, and I don't want to give it up that easy. And so I started, this went really quick, 2-3 days of like intense meet with the lawyers on the phone, talking to me, and we basically said, hey, if you want to buy it, it's this number. And it was like a crazy number that we put out. And they said, oh, are you insane? We're like, well, we don't want to sell the number. We don't want to sell the name. If you want the name and you want to buy us out of ever using it in our own branding again, that's the number. And they're like, that's insane. I'm like, well, that's the number. They're like, we'll give you half. I'm like, no, I want that number. And because we kind of knew we weren't going to sell it no matter what, we just stuck to our guns. They're like, we're not paying that. We're not going to do it. That's it. You know, we can take the name anyway. It's not trademark. And so me, Bob, and Dan discussed it. We said, you know what? Use the name. We don't care. So forget it. Use the name. We'll have our podcast called Making It, and you'll have your TV show called Making It. And everyone's going to Google Jimmy Diresta Making It or Nick Offerman Making It. And the first thing in the Google search is going to be our podcast. And people are going to be confused as hell, and they're going to come to our podcast because we have so much more search stuff up to this point. And that was the discussion with Bob and Dave had. We're like, cool. And so we called the producer, I'm like, you guys can use the name. We're like, really? You don't want any money? We're like, nope. Use the name, but we're not going to not use it. We're like, okay, cool. So there's two Making It's now. There's our podcast and a TV show. And in the world of TV, there's a slight chance the show will live on, but there's a much greater chance the show's going to air and be gone. And then our show will still have the name that we established. And because Nick was on our podcast once, he was our only guest, when you Google Nick Offerman Making It, our podcast episode shows up. So we'll see if that means anything when the show actually airs. It's going to air at the end of the summer if our podcast numbers grow. But so there's an opportunity that we took, came and fell in our lap. So we're going to have national NBC advertising for our podcast. And it didn't cost us a dime. So there's an opportunity that, you know, we could have screwed that up, we could have got offended, we could have said, we're suing you, we could be in a legal battle right now, but we're just like, take a chill, take a gamble, see where it goes. Our podcast is not going anywhere, our name is not going anywhere. That show is a volatile experience, you just don't know what's going to happen on network TV. Get to know your heroes. In this current culture, most people will at least acknowledge or at least see your tweet, at the very least. Twitter is like a public email exchange. Most part. You know, you might say that by a combination of words. I tend to answer nearly everybody that emails me. You know, the people, the young kids that email me and say, you know, you're my hero. It's really sweet to hear, and I like to acknowledge that. Get to know your heroes, the people that inspire you. It's real important. Even if you just have like one email exchange with them, somebody gives you a little bit of a boost, you know, it's definitely empowering to know that somebody acknowledges what you want to do. You need to exercise your inventive muscles, invent every day. And when I used to call my students, I would tell them, consider yourselves inventors. You really gotta consider yourselves inventors. You're not necessarily inventing, you know, some new technology, some new medicine, but by inventing images, taking pictures, inventing a channel, if you come up with something that didn't exist already, you can consider that an invention. So it's important to consider yourselves inventors and invent every day. Like if you're making a napkin holder, you're inventing a new version of the napkin holder. The design I consider an invention. An aesthetic design over a mechanical design I consider an invention. So you need to invent those, you need to exercise those muscles every day. And all this leads to developing your confidence so that rejection and failure is just a bump in the road. So that's like my whole goal. Whenever you come up with something, make sure you present it to strangers so that people will you get a real honest assessment of your design approach. I say people want to know how they can begin to make and develop products, how to sell them, put them on Instagram, give them to friends, have your friends Instagram them, have that Instagram come back to you, you can build your channel, you can build your show, you can build your gallery by giving away things. Oh, I'm going to give you this beautiful boot holder, this shoe rack, this bookshelf. Please Instagram about it for me and lead people back to me. You know, you give it to your brother, your sister, your mother, your cousin, and then their friends will see that. And you say, hey, if anybody asks you how much that costs, say it costs $2,000. And then they go, hey, can you build me one? And that's how you start to grow your client base. Don't dwell on many loss. Get up, figure out how to move on to the next level. I want to jump through so we have some time for questions. As an influencer, the smaller you are, the less control you have with advertisers. As you grow, as your audience grows, so then will your power of creative control. Let the advertisers come to you. People have 1,000 subscribers, they come to you, how do I get an advertiser? Like, you don't, you're not going to get one for a couple years. Just make kick-ass content, let your work speak for itself, and then eventually someone will see what you're doing and go, this person is in line with what we want to talk about. And then they'll contact you. At first you get free tools, there's nothing wrong with free tools, but eventually you want to transition to charging money. And that all happens naturally. It's like, you know, it's like learning how to ride a bicycle. It just happens. It's like, you know, growing up and like learning how to be an adult. Keep the ideas flowing. Even simple things can have a big impact. Always be curious about new avenues for your work and your expression. Don't fear technology. My own personal experience is CNC. I started seeing CNC machines at the Maker Faire, and I really was nervous. I really honestly got like, shit, I know I should know that, but I don't want to. You know, I should try to do that, but I don't want to learn a new program. But I got over that hump, and I'm really glad I did. I mean, it's been a tremendous, enlightening experience to learn how to CNC, laser cut, plasma cut. It's just been an amazing few years for me. And people are like, you've changed. I'm like, you've got your action. I've changed. I'm no longer, I don't have to make type on bands anymore. It's fucking great. With Bible time, self-publishing is really the only way to go. I mean, television is nice and glamorous, but TV's dying, YouTube is growing, other channels of self-expression are growing. Any one of us can be the next big thing. It's just a matter of hard work and coming up with some good, cool, holy shit moments. The more often now pictures are about selling content as you created it, you're in control. So again, nowadays, the pitches aren't necessarily about, you know, hey, I got this great TV idea, I got this great product idea. It's about dealing with advertisers. You're pitching them your concept to represent their product. And I talked a little bit about that concept where I told the guy it's more of a process, it's not a finished product. So that kind of just, I'm just trying to jump through so we can have some time. Be careful what you wish for, I talked about that. You never know where the work's gonna come from, often the oddest places. So the way I got the TV show ever, I had done a show called Trash to Cash. It was the only show I'd ever done. It was my only TV experience. And now I'm back in New York. It's about a year after I did that show. My girlfriend's friend is cutting hair at a woman's wedding. She's sending hair. The woman works at TV. She's like, oh, my friend Jeannie makes TV shows. And I'm sure she was only being nice. She's like, oh, really? She's like, can I get you guys in touch? She's like, oh, yeah, give my email. I'm sure she was just being nice. Because TV people hate giving away their email. And so I emailed this woman with a TV pitch, which became hammered. It took a year for that to happen, but that was the impetus. That little incident at somebody's wedding led to the TV show hammered being on the air. And I talk about that large table that I'm making right now, this big cedar slab. My friend Raina, the violin player, she's 16 years old. Her dad is a friend of mine, that's how I know Raina. And Raina's friend from school is a fan of mine. Long story short, Raina said, can I give Robin your number, this 15-year-old kid? I'm like, yeah, Robin calls me, I'm talking to a kid who sounds like a girl. I'm like, hey, what's up, Robin? He's like, my uncle's really rich. He needs furniture. Can I give him your number? I told him all about you. I'm like, sure. And now I'm making a $25,000 bank attempt for the guy. And he's giving me like 7 other concepts to develop for him, for his house in the Caribbean. So you never know where the work's gonna come from. You just never know. You can use your failure to learn and move on to the next level. That's a little redundant here, sorry. Take full control. After all, this is your baby. Don't do what I did for, you know, my 30s with some production company coming through all the hard work for me. Do it yourself. So that's the end of the slideshow. Does anybody have any questions? I don't know if anybody's coming up.